From the world of politics to the world of business, this is Balance of Power. Live from Washington, D.C.
From Bloomberg's Washington, D.C. studios to our TV and radio audiences worldwide, welcome to Balance of Power. Alongside Joe Matthew, I'm Kaylee Lyons.
The bipartisan border bill fails a procedural vote in the Senate, as expected. Lawmakers in the chamber now planning to move ahead on a plan B that does not include the border. Well, House Republicans pick up the pieces after two failed votes yesterday.
We'll speak with senators from both sides of the aisle. Democratic Senator Michael Bennet of Colorado and Republican Senator Bill Hagerty of Tennessee will be with us.
They'll also weigh in on breaking news. Just in the past hour, the U.S. conducting an airstrike in Iraq that killed the commander of an Iran-backed militia, called responsible for planning attacks against American forces in the region. This just emerging now, Kaylee, as so many folks have asked, what is next? But it's the border, or the failure to pass a border bill, that's really rocking the Capitol today.
Absolutely. Has rocked the Capitol for several days now. And, of course, it seems that what the Senate may be moving forward with will not include the border at all, but some other supplemental funding measures for issues like Israel and what's happening in the Middle East, as well as Ukraine. But we've seen time and again that this is an uphill battle for both chambers, Joe.
That's right. And we're looking right now at a live view of the Senate, a live view of the floor, which is pretty quiet at the moment, having had that earlier failed vote on the procedural vote on this border deal. Kaylee, they spent so much time negotiating, said to be dead on arrival in the House, and I guess the same could be said for the Senate. Plan B would bring funding for Ukraine, for Israel, for Taiwan without the attached border. And that's where we start our conversation with Democratic Senator Michael Bennet of Colorado. It's good to see you, Senator. A lot happening in your chamber, as we're trying to describe today. Is this new standalone bill that Chuck Schumer is bringing to the floor something that can pass? Does it have the votes?
Well, I think it can pass. We don't know whether it has the votes, Joe. We're going to have to put it on the floor, and the Senate is going to work its will. This is one of those moments in American history when we literally can't predict the vote. And at least in my view, this is one of the most consequential votes every member of the Senate is going to take, because the future of Western democracy, I think, depends on it. The Ukrainian people have fought bravely for the last 2 years. They have shocked the world in what they've been able to do against Putin's illegal invasion of their country. They've taken back half the territory. They fought battle after battle after battle. It's been extraordinary. And now the question falls to our country, whether we're going to support them in that battle, whether we're going to join the European nations who recognize the threat that Putin is to them, and whether we're going to acknowledge the important role the United States has to provide in leadership. I hope the answer, Joe and Kaylee, is not just that we will support this, but that there will be a very large vote in the Senate so we can send a message to the House of Representatives that we're out of time, that this is a moment when America's resolve is being tested by tyrants, and that America has to show once-in-a-lifetime leadership here.
But the Speaker of the House, Senator, has been warned that if he puts anything that would give more aid to Ukraine on the floor, he would face a motion to vacate. Given everything you just said, the importance you think there is of getting this aid through, would you encourage your colleagues, Democratic colleagues in the House, to offer to protect the Speaker to make this happen?
I wouldn't give advice to the House members. I can tell you that I certainly believe that somebody who is able to put together a bipartisan vote that continued to allow the funding for Ukraine should be worthy of being the Speaker of the House. That's my view. I mean, I have been holding up budgets around here. I've been holding up everything I can hold up around here when we've been passing things that have not included the Ukraine aid. I think this is a moment when people look, there's not a reason for us to be here, any of us to be here, if we can't get this aid passed. And that's how I believe it. And I don't know whether the Speaker's going to see it the same way. I hope he does.
Well, we actually heard earlier today from Florida Senator Rick Scott about the other half of this, Senator. I'm assuming you'd still like to see a deal on the border. It sounds like a lot of Democrats would, maybe more than Republicans in your chamber at this point. Here's what the senator from Florida had to say. We'll have you respond.
Why don't we go back and secure the border with the existing law? I mean, we have a lawless president. It doesn't matter what bill we pass. He's not going to enforce it. So why isn't, you know, Joe Biden do his job?
What's your view on that, Senator? Because that's become the refrain the last couple of weeks with a lot of Republican lawmakers who say we don't actually need a bill. The president can do it all on his own.
I know, Joe. Listen, man. This was a bill about Ukraine and a bill about Israel and a bill about Taiwan. That's what this bill was about. The Republicans in the Senate said, we will not pass a bill unless you guys do something serious about the border. Because obviously the implication of that was we had to pass a law in order to do something serious about the border. And I think what shocked them was that Joe Biden came a very long way in that negotiation. Urged, among other people, by me, I have stood up over and over again. I said, you know, I thought the Biden administration was wrong to lift Title 42. I've brought to their attention over and over that I felt that our border was broken. And we got to a bipartisan agreement, and then they walked away. I mean, the American people are going to have to make their own assessment about this. But just to connect your observation and Kaylee's observation about the speaker, I was part of the Gang of Eight who wrote the comprehensive immigration bill in 2013. It got 68 votes in the Senate. It went over to the House. It died. John Boehner, a guy I have a lot of respect for, who was the Republican speaker at the time, said the worst mistake he ever made as speaker was not putting that bill on the floor and letting the House work its will. So the point is, sometimes things are more important than a politician's job. Sometimes the American people have a real, you know, expectation that's more than that, just we're going to point fingers. But that we're actually, when we say we're going to solve something on the border, we're going to solve something on the border. And we're going to say we're going to help protect democracy for our kids and for our grandkids and provide American leadership that they actually mean it and that we actually believe it. This is one of those moments, I think.
Well, we'll see if this indeed does reach the House floor. There's other legislation that already not only reached the floor, but actually passed with a major bipartisan majority in the House, this bipartisan tax deal that in part would expand the child tax credit. What is the fate of that legislation going to be in the Senate? Can it pass without serious amending?
It got a massive vote in the House, and it should pass in the Senate. I don't think it needs to be amended. I think it's a good piece of legislation. I ran a virtually completely unnoticed campaign for president on the idea that we could cut childhood poverty in this country by half by increasing the child tax credit. While it doesn't go as far as I would want, it makes substantial progress. And as you said, it's bipartisan, which that has to be a relief to the American people. I hope we get a big bipartisan vote in the Senate on Ukraine. I really do. It would be good for our standing in the world.
Senator Bennet, there's been another airstrike. This just something we've learned about in the past hour or so. You've probably known about it for longer from your perch on the Intelligence Committee. Yeah. The U.S. conducted an airstrike that killed the commander of an Iran-backed militia in Iraq is where this happened. Central Command has confirmed this, saying that this person, not named, was responsible for directly planning and participating in attacks on U.S. forces in the region. What else do you know about it? What are you hearing?
Well, what I know is we should expect more and more and more out of this, out of Iran and their proxies, and it's going to be very important for us to act in a way that deters the Iranians and makes sure that this dispute, this war that is happening between Israel and Gaza and Hamas, is not something that's going to spill out into the broader region. And every single day, Iran's proxies are testing us and testing us and testing us, and they need to know that we are going to respond to that and that we are paying attention to what they're doing. So this is not something that you can deter in one day or even one week or I would say even one month. We have to be vigilant about this day after day after day, and that's, I think that's what you're seeing today.
Well, but as you see these proxy groups continuing to conduct attacks in the Red Sea and against U.S. forces, is there any real sign that things are improving, that deterrence efforts are even starting to work, even if they haven't worked entirely? What does the intelligence suggest?
I would not say things are improving. I'd say this is a very dangerous moment in the Middle East. I'd say that the Iranians' proxies are trying to decide how to gain the most advantage in this war as they can. And as I said, we're going to have to be vigilant. And in my view, we've got to get to a place where we can begin to figure out how to have a negotiation about a two-state solution between Israel and the Palestinian people that can begin to create some order in this part of the world. That's not going to happen today or tomorrow, but I think that the United States of America can't take our eye off that goal. And in the meantime, we've got to make sure that we don't allow this to escalate into a wider war.
If these strikes continue, if these attacks continue and the tit for tat goes on without seeing improvement here, Senator, would you support strikes directly against Iran?
Well, I don't want to state any hypothetical. What I would say to you is that I expect that this will continue, that Iran and their proxies will continue to test us and continue to test us, and we're going to have to make a judgment. The president's going to have to make a judgment every single day about what the correct deterrence is and how to push back. That's an assessment that they literally have to make every day, every hour, every day. That's what we're going to continue to have to do.
All right, Senator, thank you so much for joining us this evening.
So
it's Democratic Senator Michael Bennet of Colorado.
Thanks.
We appreciate your time, sir. Now, coming up, we'll hear from the other side of the aisle in the Senate. Republican Senator Bill Hagerty of Tennessee will be with us next. This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg TV and radio. This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg TV and radio. We're joined now by Senator Bill Hagerty, the Republican from Tennessee, who's with us this evening from Capitol Hill. Senator, as always, great to see you. Thank you for joining Bloomberg. We were just speaking with one of your Democratic colleagues, the senator from Colorado, Michael Bennet, who was speaking about what he sees as the utmost importance of passing aid to Ukraine. It seems the Senate is now going to have a chance, after voting down the deal that included border security, to vote on a package that does not include border security, but Ukraine and Israel aid, funding for Taiwan in there as well. Can this pass if it couldn't pass with the border attached?
I think it's going to be very difficult. The reason the piece with the border in it didn't pass was because there are significant problems and challenges with the border bill as it was drafted. If you look at it from a 50,000-foot level, what the bill does, on the border at least, is offer over $20 billion more dollars, new dollars, and new authorities to an administration that hasn't enforced the law. What it does is it actually codifies some of the things that have been going on here in terms of catch and release, uses Orwellian terms like non-custodial detention. I'm sure when you were a kid, you wouldn't want to go to detention hall with no custodian. I mean, things like this need to be fixed and addressed. That's what you saw in the earlier
vote. But, Senator, that's
all. It's got to be fixed.
You're referring to the bill that effectively is now dead unless it's somehow resurrected. My question is about what you could have a chance to vote on now going forward. Would you, and do you think enough of your colleagues on the Republican side, would be supportive of passing something that did not include those border measures but did provide funding to our allies?
Certainly, I won't be there. We've got to deal with our own national security before we deal with the national security of other nations. We've got to fix this and we've got to address it. This isn't the time, in my view, to bring the Ukraine bill, Taiwan, everything else to the floor. What we need to be doing is addressing our own security first. We didn't get there today, and we're not going to get there by voting on something without any border security either. And I think it will have very grim prospects in the House of Representatives.
Well, what we're hearing, Senator, is you're never going to vote on any kind of a border bill, or certainly pass one, as long as Donald Trump is running for president, that he wants this to be a campaign issue, that a number of Republican lawmakers do as well. Is this a matter that our listeners and viewers will have to wait for the election to see resolved?
That is, I know that's a talking point that's coming from the Democrat side, certainly coming out of the White House, but that is not correct at all. What amazes me is that in 2021, this White House, this administration, there's no problem at our southern border. There's no crisis there. 2022, the border is secure. 2023, there's no problem, no crisis, ask Secretary Mayorkas. Now suddenly there's a crisis, and they're pointing to Republicans as the one being in charge of this, being responsible for it. That is not correct. What's been put forward in terms of this bill doesn't get us there, doesn't get us where we need to get, and I am more than willing to work on something that will get us there. But this bill did not cut the mustard, and it will not work.
I know that you think we should be focused on our borders domestically, but of course, Americans don't just exist in the confines of the country. There are Americans that are now troops finding themselves in danger in the Middle East as we continue to see the conducting of attacks from Iranian proxies. We did get news within the last hour or so that there has been a strike conducted by the U.S. in Iraq that has killed a commander of the Iran-backed militia that the U.S. says is responsible for planning some of these attacks. What is the farthest step that the Biden administration should take here? Should we be attacking Iran directly, striking them at home, or would that escalate things in the region and put troops in even greater danger?
Again, let's take a step back. What we've done is we've been extraordinarily inconsistent in dealing with Iran and its proxies. You've got a military presence there. You just cited the most recent military action. That should be a deterrent, but it will not work if our diplomatic posture and our economic posture are not consistent. In fact, what we're doing is we have failed to enforce the sanctions on Iran that would have stopped the flow of funds to that nation. What they've been able to do since Joe Biden came into office is they've unleashed the flow of illicit oil sales. I worked in the previous administration. I was U.S. ambassador to Japan. One of my jobs was to get the Japanese to stop buying Iranian crude oil. We did that. We put maximum pressure on Iran. What happened? Their reserves came down to below $8 billion. Now they're well over $100 billion because the money began to flow immediately when the Bidens came into office.
So what would you do now, Senator? What would Bill Hagerty do?
I would put the harshest economic sanctions in place right now. I would make it very clear that Iranian oil sales are no more. I would use every sanction in the book and make our economic sanctions line up with our military posture. I would make our diplomatics speak very clear as well that we will not tolerate this. And as you see military action, we should not be taking anything off the table. Instead, this administration telegraphs, hours and days ahead that they're going to strike back. They're going to say that we don't want to escalate anything with Iran. Well, guess what? You take escalation off the table, you take a big tool of deterrence off the table. We need to come back to a strong diplomatic, economic, and military position to deal with Iran. It needs to be consistent.
Do you believe, sir, then, that economic sanctions on Iran will actually cause Iranian proxies who say they do not actually take direct directives from Tehran itself to cease all of their behavior? How strong do you think the link really is that just going after Iran economically would translate to changes in military-esque behavior?
Well, under President Trump, it certainly did work, because by 2019, 2020, it was widely reported that Hamas and Hezbollah were broke. What that message would send to Iran, you know that this is Iranian funding going there. You know this is Iranian technology and Iranian know-how behind the Houthis, behind Hezbollah, behind Hamas. It would send a very strong message. And Iran, I know they say that they don't control these proxies, but I think you know the truth of the matter. They absolutely do.
And, Senator, finally, obviously, we've been asking you these questions as a member of the Foreign Relations Committee. You are also a member of the Senate Banking Committee, and tomorrow you will have the chance to question Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen. She was before the House Financial Services Committee yesterday and was asked about what we're seeing with NYCB and commercial real estate challenges that some of these banks are facing. NYCB, of course, the poster child right now. To what degree are you concerned about that, and do you think the Treasury Secretary's answers on this issue specifically yesterday were adequate?
I think there's a lot to be concerned about here. You're talking about the bank that acquired Signature Bank's assets. That bank is highly concentrated in New York. The commercial real estate portfolio there has a lot of office space that is not being fully utilized right now. I think you've got to look at this on a state-by-state, region-by-region basis to understand what the risk looks like, but I'd very much like to know how she's thinking about it, how regulators are thinking about it, because it is a matter of concern. Also, the debt issuance that's underway. We're issuing a record amount of debt right now. Record amounts of debt right now. I'd like to know how she's thinking about managing Treasury auctions going forward as well. It should be an interesting day tomorrow with the Secretary.
Yeah. Senator, when should the Fed start cutting?
That's the question of the hour. I think when they should start cutting is when the numbers and tell them to do so. The Fed has said it's data-driven. It needs to stick to that and not respond to political pressure. And I think you know this. The Fed is getting a tremendous amount of political pressure right now from the other side of the aisle. Letters come from Sherrod Brown, from Elizabeth Warren, trying to press them to go ahead and start cutting rates right now. They want to see the economy shift into high gear coming into the election. The Fed should not succumb to political pressure. The Fed should remain data-driven and maintain its reputation in the process.
Appreciate it, Senator. Bill Hagerty, it's great
to have
you back.
Always good to be with
you. On Bloomberg, sir. For reaction now to what we just heard from both senators today, a D and an R, we turn to Bloomberg Government's Jonathan Samari, who's been on Capitol Hill for the balance of the day. Jonathan, thanks for being with us multiple times in your coverage throughout the day here. This has been a wild 24 hours. As Kaylee was describing, we saw this border cloture vote fail. Now we're going to Plan B. I couldn't tell, and I don't know about you, Kaylee, the senator's obviously not voting for it. I couldn't tell if he expected it to pass. Do you?
The border bill?
Yeah. No,
this the no border
B,
bill.
The plan B for funding Ukraine, Israel, Taiwan with no border.
Yeah, I think Democrats expect that this will be able to get Republican votes to pass the Senate. But right now, as I left the Hill just about an hour ago, there was a lot of negotiations going on. There was talks internally among Republicans about what they might ask for. A number of them want to have amendment votes where they can put some border proposals forward and force people to go on the record about those things. And Democrats were going to have to then negotiate with them. Once Republicans settle their disagreement, then negotiate with Democrats about what kind of amendments they would have. But I think the Democrats think this has a path to get there, that there will be enough Republicans that support this bill. The big question will be on the House side, where it's much more of a wild card even.
Well, we know that the Senate Minority Leader Mitch McConnell very much does support aid for Ukraine, yet things haven't exactly gone his way within his conference in the last several days. Have we learned that he no longer actually has the power to whip his Republicans into shape and to vote for something like this?
Certainly not like it was in the past, and he's not the only one, right? We saw the Wall Street Journal editorial board, the U.S. Chamber of Commerce all endorsing this border and foreign aid bill and didn't get the job done. A lot of the Republican Party is moving in another direction. We've seen that for some time now, starting with the Tea Party, accelerated by Donald Trump. And Trump has really reshaped the party to be a party that is combative, that is disinclined to compromise, and really favors clashes over compromises.
I want to ask you about something else that happened today that was in the last 24 hours, it's all blurring together now.
Yes.
An attempted impeachment for the first time in 150 years, almost, of a cabinet official. That's Alejandro Mayorkas, the Homeland Security Secretary. It failed with some drama as Al Green came in from his hospital bed, wheeled in scrubs to vote to essentially save the secretary. Though we did hear from Speaker Mike Johnson today that they're coming back around when there's full attendance, and they do plan to try to impeach him again. We heard from Alejandro Mayorkas. The secretary was in Las Vegas for a Super Bowl-related event earlier today.
The allegations are baseless, and I'm focused on the work, which was what brings me to Las Vegas today.
Republicans have indicated they may hold another vote, and they might have the numbers at that point to impeach you. If that happened, would you consider stepping aside?
No, I would not.
So he's keeping that job, right? Even if the House does come back and impeach him, that wouldn't go through the Senate.
Right. Senator Schumer has pretty much dismissed this impeachment. It's unclear if they would even hold a trial. If they did, it would probably be very short. So it's likely that Republicans could impeach him. But as you said, I mean, even we thought that was likely to happen last night, and that imploded. So very unpredictable. As much as we say Mitch McConnell might not have the grip he once had, Speaker Johnson certainly has not had that in his tenure as the leader of the House.
Yeah, really hard to count the votes, apparently.
Yes.
Is that not just about Speaker Johnson, though, but also potentially Tom Emmer, too?
Yeah. I mean, you have to look at the entire Republican leadership when you have two things that are supposed to be major political statements, and they both fall flat on their face on the same night.
Back to back.
Yes.
Yeah. Why go through with the second vote? That is a question I think a lot of us have had in the last 24 hours. Thank you for your wonderful reporting on that, as always. Bloomberg Government's Jonathan Tamari. Now coming up, Bloomberg's exclusive interview with the new CEO of Carlyle Group, Harvey Schwartz. We'll have more on what he thinks the 2024 election means for markets, and the answer may be actually not all that much. So stay tuned for that conversation. This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg TV and radio.
I don't think we should be rooting for 5 or 8 rate cuts. I think that would suggest an environment that actually requires a lot of attention from the Fed. We would expect the base case to be 2 or 3 cuts. The Fed, we expect to be very data sensitive. We're watching this closely also. But again, my crystal ball may be as good as yours. So we'll see what happens.
That was Carlyle Group CEO Harvey Schwartz in an exclusive interview with Bloomberg's Shanali Bosick on the Fed's efforts in taming inflation. That interview conducted this morning in Washington, D.C., and Shanali is still here with us on set for more. So, Shanali, it was a very wide-ranging conversation. Great interview. What were some of the other highlights for you?
Well, a few things is this kind of sanguine tone he had about the economic environment, right? It's an interesting thing. The wall of worry is large about the economy in an election year. I want you guys to take a listen quickly to what he had to say about what the market would do in the event of uncertain elections.
I think the S&P 500 has gone through 23 election cycles. In 23 election cycles, roughly 80%+ of the time, Democrat, Republican, the S&P 500 has gone up. I'd like to see us get through an election cycle, and I'd like to see everyone in Washington really start to come together, because we do have complex problems, and coming together is the way we're going to solve them.
As evidenced by a soaring stock market today, once again, Kaylee. And so for someone like that, remember, Washington is a home base for Carlyle. Carlyle is one of the few large private equity firms of its size that counts Washington as a home base. So they do think about this a lot. In fact, their chief economist used to work in the administration as well. And so that's where that information is coming from. So they're really shaking off worries. Not everyone on Wall Street feels that way. A lot of people are really worried about the policies. But more and more, I'm hearing investors getting more worried about what 2025 looks like rather than what the year looks like alone in the event of a volatile election year.
When we talk about volatility, do you mean election interference? Do you mean violence like we saw on January 6th? Is it all of the above?
It's all of the above, and uncertainty about the candidates themselves. What would happen under a Trump administration versus a Biden administration, part two, for example? Let me draw out some scenarios, for example. There are a lot of questions about what tariffs would look like.
Mm-hmm. And 60% plus, potentially, under a new Trump administration.
There's, of course, that spending question as well, what that looks like versus the tax cuts. You even have prominent Republicans also saying the tax cuts will be needed no matter what, given how large this deficit has become. And so those problems, a lot of investors don't believe will really bake in this year, as evidenced, for example, by the 10-year bond sale that you've seen today going quite smoothly. There was a lot of anxiety by investors about what today's 10-year sale would look like as the Treasury issues more debt. And guess what? It's been pretty smooth, hasn't it? And so even when I raised with Harvey Schwartz the prospect of even a government shutdown, would that worry you? Investors are shaking it off, and they're looking to 2025 as the year when the chickens really come home to roost, because that's when some of these policies would start to settle in.
It's a great perspective. You need to come down more often to Washington.
Right? Really liked you.
Shanali Bosick, of course, star from New York with us in the Capitol. Thank you, Shanali. Great to see you. 2023 was a big year for organized labor. We spoke with Jennifer Abruzzo, general counsel for the National Labor Relations Board, a short time ago, and asked her for whether that employee momentum that we saw last year will carry into this one.
What we're seeing is workers feeling more empowered to engage with their employers about their wages and working conditions.
Because they're seeing deals struck successfully.
I think so. But, you know, it's not only about unionization, although, you know, the whole high-profile organizing drives mm-hmm. are certainly helping. I think workers realize we add value to our employers' operations, and we should be respected for that, and we should also make gains ourselves and not only, you know, add to the profits of our employers' operations. So, but we are seeing, you know, workers that it may not be about wages. It may be about training opportunities or discrimination in the workplace, or it could be any number of things. But they are elevating their voices now and seeking a seat at the bargaining table. So I think that we're going to see more of that going into 2024.
Well, and of course, 2024 is also significant because it is an election year, and the incumbent president has said that he is the most pro-labor president in U.S. history. How much do you think that workers who may want to unionize, or even you at the NLRB, feel a rush to maybe get that done before November? How much needs to be accomplished in the months in between now and then?
Yeah. So I think for unions and for workers writ large, I you know, my statute is all about protecting the right to engage in union activity, as well as protect a concerted activity, which means improving your work circumstance, whatever it is, flexible scheduling, like the Starbucks workers, for example. It's less about money. It's more about, you know, work-life balance, right? And so I think that we're going to see definitely there'll be a push this year, but our statute has been in existence since 1935. Workers have been unionizing and engaging in other activity, you know, for 90 years now. So regardless of who's in the White House, I think we're going to continue to see workers' momentum. And I would say that this year, of course, it's a big election year and the like, but I think what we're going to continue to see is just solidarity building.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned Starbucks. Mm-hmm. I think of Amazon. You've received over 100 complaints from mm-hmm. Starbucks alone based on Bloomberg's reporting. Do you worry about the risk surrounding this moment, the stakes here, if these waves of unionization do not take hold? What happens to corporate behavior?
I don't worry about that because, A, I think they are going to take hold, but and, B, we are seeing on the ground. So I'm the prosecutor, and I will say I provide guidance. Mm-hmm. I don't make the law. The board members actually do that. But even just by issuing my guidance, I see a difference on the ground in terms of employer behavior. So I think that we're going to continue to see, you know, better employer behavior. I mean, certainly those that have deeper pockets may want to challenge it more. But I do foresee that, you know, we are actually seeing that we are changing behavior on the ground that is for the betterment of workers.
Speaking of employers, let's talk about one in particular that has been in the news, Dartmouth University. Mm-hmm. It employs, I'm sure, a number of professors and administrative staff, and now apparently it employs men's basketball players.
Yes.
After the NLRB ruled that the Dartmouth men's basketball team can unionize, should hold a union election, that they are employees of Dartmouth University. Is the end road here, the end game, that there is no more an amateur student athlete, that these athletes are not amateurs, they are professionals, and they are employed by the universities they play for?
So it's going to come down to case by case. I don't think that every, and I say players at academic institutions because student athletes has
sure.
this other connotation, but you got to look on the facts on the ground. A statutory employee is one who performs services for an institution, and that institution controls significant aspects of their working lives. In the Dartmouth case, in the case that we're litigating, the USC case that we're litigating in California, similarly, we found that they were statutory employees because of the amount of control that the institution had over their daily lives. So it may be, and you know, we see it in college basketball, we see it in college football, it may be in other sports as well, but I can't say, you know, I do think there's an issue with amateurism in these profit-making enterprises when it comes to quite a number of sports teams. But I can't say in all situations that every student athlete now is going to be considered a statutory employee. I don't foresee that happening.
That was Jennifer Abruzzo, General Counsel for the National Labor Relations Board, speaking with Joe and I earlier today. And we have more conversations coming up on both Bloomberg Television and radio. The Senate delivered a blow to efforts to impose new border restrictions. The bill is now effectively dead, but it would have been dead in the House anyway. So we'll be joined by our political panel to break all that down next. This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg.
We're
we're governing here. Sometimes it's messy. You know, the framers anticipated that you would have a system where people with very different philosophical viewpoints that come from different parts of the country and different constituencies would have different ideas on how to resolve their problems. But what they also anticipated is that we'd be able to get in a room and arm wrestle over public policy and come to consensus to move the ball forward for the most people. That is what's happening here. You're seeing the messy sausage making, the process of democracy play out.
Program brought to you by the word messy today. That was House Speaker Mike Johnson talking to reporters this morning following the failure last night of the Mayorkas impeachment vote and the standalone Israeli aid bill. They came one after the other. And joining us now, our political panel to help us make sense of all of this, Kristen Hahn of Rock Solutions, Lauren Tomlinson, partner at Steer PR, with us around the table. It's great to see you both here. Lauren, it strikes me that democracy would be a lot less messy if you actually knew you had the votes when you brought these bills to the floor. That was totally preventable yesterday, wasn't it?
It was definitely preventable if he had had a better whip count. And I, you know, but I think that we have had very good speakers in the past, so maybe our viewpoints on all of this are skewed. You know, speakers that had very tight controls and very good whip counts. So, you know, Johnson might be figuring this out a little bit as he goes. He did get the, you know, bipartisan tax reform bill through the House, you know, with a nice moderate majority. So, you know, it's not impossible for him to pass things. But, I mean, it was embarrassing that he did these back to back. And I think the messaging part of it mostly, too, if you were trying to make a point on Israel and show that Democrats weren't willing to vote on a clean bill and maybe detract from some of the other negotiations and storylines that were going on, having a failed Mayorkas impeachment, you know, was not going to allow you to take that storyline and run with it.
So it all paints a picture of a speaker that is very much struggling in his relatively still nascent speakership. And we actually asked former Congressman Denver Riggleman, who was a Republican from Virginia earlier today, about Johnson and also his relationship with Donald Trump. Take a listen.
Mike Johnson is beyond him on a leadership level. If he can't step out and do what's right for the country without having Donald Trump looking over his shoulder, this chaos is going to continue. So there's a rot in the body of Congress, and all that comes from Mar-a-Lago.
So if there is a rot in the body of Congress, as Mr. Riggleman says, and if the speaker isn't actually able to speak about that much, maybe he's more a spokesperson in some senses, if you're believing Mr. Riggleman's argument here, what can he get done? What can this Congress get done at all in this election year?
Nothing if he doesn't work with Democrats. I mean, we talked about the bipartisan tax package. It passed with a healthy, like you said, moderate majority of these people. It's very clear that, you know, he's taking his cues from Mar-a-Lago. He's taking his cues from President Trump. This was a very ambitious package that the president did not want to have happen. And unfortunately, you have a speaker who's putting politics, in front of good policy. And, you know, I think that if he went to Hakeem Jeffries, the Democratic leader, and said, hey, let's figure out how to put together a majority of votes on the floor, both Democrats and Republicans, he could get it done. But until he does that, until he stops going to the far right and looking to those
so
few
you think
people.
Essentially, if he asked nicely, he could have gotten that Israel bill to pass.
I don't think if he asked nicely, but I think if he goes to the Democrats in good faith, I think if you go to them in good faith and say, I need these votes, what would it take to get something done? Rather than just say, before he even sees the language in the broader bill, just decide that it's not going to work.
There was drama all around last night, another late night in the House. I thought it was something like out of House of Cards. For a little story time here, the impeachment of Alejandro Mayorkas was about to pass. Republicans had a single vote. And crashing through the door comes Al Green, the Democrat from Texas, wearing scrubs in a wheelchair, rushed to the floor from his hospital bed where he had just had emergency surgery. He cast the tie-breaking vote, or I guess he tied it up, and then that caused Republicans to pull back after. But he was accused of having some kind of a conspiracy here, and I spoke with him a little bit earlier. He was back in his hospital bed on the phone. I asked him about the impeachment of the Homeland Security Secretary. Here's what he said.
I talked to the staff here at the hospital. I talked to the physicians, my surgical team. I talked to the administration. And I had to negotiate with them. I had to sign a document explaining to me the possible harm that could befall me. I did it, and I called Speaker Jeffries. Yes, they were reluctant to do it, I will be candid, because they were concerned about me, and I love them for being concerned. But I had to cast this vote. This is my job.
Took an Uber, apparently, and then right back to the hospital. Okay. He did tell me, though, that when this comes back around, Speaker Johnson has promised that it will, that Mayorkas will be impeached. He used to work for DHS. Is that going to happen?
I mean, I hope not. I think it's bad precedent for them to impeach cabinet secretaries if they disagree with the president's policies. And ultimately, everything that they're talking about, Congress could fix. Right. If Congress actually legislated and authorized, for example, I know one of the issues is that they're upset that the states can't sue and the states can't enforce their own immigration laws. Congress could authorize that the states are allowed to do that. Right. If they pass legislation. So a lot of what they're complaining about is a difference in policies. It's not Mayorkas's job to do everything and enforce everything that Congress wants. He's enforcing what Biden wants. Right. It's part of the executive branch. So if they don't like it, they need to pass new laws and then require him to do so. And then he will have to do it. I think the non-enforcement, you would have to impeach every cabinet secretary at that point. Right. Because people aren't enforcing things all the time based on the policy priorities of the president in charge. So, you know, I think it's demoralizing for DHS. I think it sets bad precedent. And also, I don't think that it actually solves anything. And it's a bad look for the Republicans.
Well, speaking of bad looks for the Republicans, we've talked at length about Speaker Johnson and how he may have been embarrassed on two fronts last night. But what about the Senate Minority Leader Mitch McConnell? He has been advocating for Ukraine aid, advocating to attach a border deal to it. The package was there. And members of his own leadership team, close allies, decided to turn away from him. Why is he sticking around? Why should he if he can't exercise control over his members?
It's remarkable. And he's a very talented leader, and he's proven himself to be a very good vote counter in the past. And it amazes me to see Republicans just one after the other just do what Donald Trump wants. I mean, it's so clear. It's not a talking point. The president doesn't want this issue off the table before the election. He wants to run on it. And at some point, I guess, you know, McConnell just has to look at his party and, you know, just say, he doesn't run that caucus or that conference anymore. It's the former president.
All right. Well, speaking of the former president, he, of course, also is trying to be president again. There is a 2024 primary race that is underway. So we'll be back with our political panel next to discuss that, because in Nevada, none of the above gained more votes on the ballot in the state's primary than Nikki Haley did last night. We'll get reaction to that next. This is Balance of Power on Bloomberg TV and radio.
So you look at this race and you see we had 14 people in the race. We got rid of a dozen of the fellas. We just got one more that we got to catch up to. We started with 2% in Iowa. We finished with 20%. We went to Nevada, and Trump said we'd be down by 30 points. We got 43% of the vote.
That was Republican presidential candidate Nikki Haley in Orange County earlier today, a day after the ballot selection. None of these candidates got more votes than she did in the Nevada primary. She did get 43% of the vote in New Hampshire, not in Nevada. Of course, in Nevada, Trump was not on that ballot with her yesterday because he'll be competing in the state's caucus, the Republican one, tomorrow, and is therefore expected to take all of the delegates. Let's go back now to our political panel, Kristen Hahn of Rock Solutions and Lauren Tomlinson, partner at Steer PR. So, Lauren, certainly it's not a great look to lose to what effectively is just any other option but you. Is all this is, though, for her an optics problem? She wasn't really trying in Nevada. She's looking ahead to South Carolina.
Yeah, it's horrible headlines, I think. But ultimately what this was is it was a bunch of Donald Trump supporters protesting her vote. It was, you know, it was never that people were searching for something else. It was an active campaign by Donald Trump supporters to embarrass her a little bit and do the protest vote. So not a great storyline. But again, she wasn't competing there. So maybe we'll have better news out of South Carolina. But it's really hard to build momentum messaging that you're doing well with a headline like that.
Well, gosh, I'll date myself here, but it reminds me of the Richard Pryor movie Brewster's Millions. Remember? He ran a write-in campaign for none of the above.
Yes.
And none of the above won. That was crazy because it was a movie, but it actually happened last night.
Yes.
Kristen, should she have tried to campaign here, or would it have run afoul with the party?
I mean, she's got limited resources, so she's trying to figure out where to put, you know, all of her efforts. So I get that she was doing, you know, focusing on South Carolina, given mm-hmm. it's her home state. But maybe put a little bit more effort in. You know, this is a terrible headline. You know, it because she's talking about the momentum, you know, like you just showed. And, you know, this just kind of, that whole message just goes away.
Yeah, falls flat.
Falls flat.
And speaking of angering potentially the Republican Party, the head of the Republican Party, the RNC, Ronna McDaniel, apparently has angered the frontrunner, former President Trump, a little too much because she's going to resign after South Carolina, according to Bloomberg's reporting and others. Who replaces her, Lauren?
You know, they're talking about different party leaders in states that Trump supports. I'm curious to see, you know, what ends up happening with that race. But, you know, she didn't run afoul of Donald Trump as much as she did Turning Points USA. If you are familiar, it's the grassroots conservative youth organization. And people were saying that she wasn't fundraising in the way that she should. So there was a lot of party pushback, I think, on where the RNC was going and what their main focus was here. But the nail in the coffin, I think, was running afoul of Donald Trump at that point. So I'm curious to see what ends up happening. And, you know, they'll have to have an election. It's not an appointment. So we'll see how it goes.
You know, among the names being floated, we have less than a minute here, Kristen, the chair of the new North Carolina Republican Party, who is an election denier. Would Democrats mm-hmm. like to run against a party that's helmed by a Stop the Steal guy, as they call him?
I mean, I think nobody wants the head of their party to be somebody like that. So do I want it for the good of the nation? No. You know, but this is somebody, it looks like, if you work for Donald Trump, you run afoul of him, and there's a good chance that you do. Look at your Reince Priebus. Hmm. You know, you're going to be ousted. So.
Well, this will be another contest for us to watch your kid. Yep. Our thanks to Kristen Hahn and Lauren Tomlinson for a great conversation. Check out the Washington Edition newsletter on the terminal and online.
And, of course, come back and see us tomorrow. Thank you so much for joining us on Balance of Power on both Bloomberg TV and radio.